I'd like to start off, I guess, just talking about a couple of people who've been very important to me, and I'll make this quick, which was Harry Callahan and Aaron Siskin, who were two of my teachers, and I trust most of you know who they are, and the third person being Ray Metzger. And I just talked to Ray a very little while ago, and he is very sick and is probably not going to pull through. And he's important he's important historically, as he was important personally to me. And at the end of the conversation, in a very weak voice, he said, "It's your turn, Tom," which meant an awful lot to me. I would never claim to follow his footsteps with the way that he walked, but he was important to me, and I would dedicate this to him. What I'm going to do today is go through about 40 years of work, because I think it's important. I'm really aiming this talk at the students here. I think it's important to know where work comes from and how work may develop. The other reason I wanted to do it this way is because this notion of timeline, which is what the show addresses and this new publication addresses, is the linkage between different times in our life and different times in different kinds of images. I have become more and more interested in the dialogue that pictures can have with each other. I still love the individual print, but for me at this point, I'm very interested in how images can talk to one another. That's what, in some way, timeline is about, and what this presentation is going to be about. There are about, 20 or 25 bodies of work that I'm representing, most of them being represented in two pictures, which is in some way impossible, but it'll give you a hint, it'll give you a flavor of what the pictures address. It also made me think a lot as I was editing this about how an exhibit on the wall works like this, and how a book works. And it's stuff I think most of us know. A book, or at least the book that I just published, has far more pictures in it, and I'm able to tell a story, a narrative in the book, although not linear, it's still a narrative that the few pictures on the wall I feel really can't address. You just, again, get a shadow of the story that I want to tell. I'm going to end the presentation, which I've never done before, with new work in progress, which may never exist, or it might change a lot when it gets out into the world. So, if I could have the lights. I'm starting way, way back in time. I've always thought of myself as a landscape photographer. Always thought of myself as a landscape photographer who is interested in metaphor. The early work was strongly influenced by Minor White and his notion of the equivalence. So I'm just going to show you a couple of these. They're pretty traditional landscape. I'm interested in what's not in the photograph, of what we can make like disappear, and what we leave behind. So these two pictures out of the past, and they were made in probably 1971 maybe, and I was working with a view camera out in nature, interested in being out in the world as I always have been, but also interested in wiping out a kind of context that leaves you with an essence of what was there. So just two pictures from way back. This is a body of work called A Night Walks, and I was visiting my mother, who was on her way out, and I would sit by her bed all day, and then in the evening when she'd sleep, I would walk in the jungle near where she was living. I was using open strobe, for those of you who know a little bit about photo, long exposure, handheld, with a strobe flash popping off. So it renders part of the world that reflects the most light from the strobe, and the world which is closest to the lens with a kind of sharpness. And then because of the camera movement, the rest of the world gets very dreamlike, very blurry. That's the end of that sequence. I was doing a lot of flying back and forth, A, to visit my mother. And every time I'd get off the plane, she'd be in a more and more deteriorated state. And that flight was really hard for me. And instead of giving it a lot of thought, ruminating on the way down what she'd be like, I decided I should make I should make pictures out of the window in the plane. And unlike most aerial photographers, I was most interested in when there was a cloud cover and the world below me, I could barely see. It would start to disappear. So the prints were very precise in some way, in that they were very light in value, with a hint of information coming forward. That bottom strip was, I had a little half-frame camera with me, and on takeoff, I would lean forward in my seat and shoot as fast as I could. And I guess in part what I was interested in is the G-forces that were pushing me back and the struggle I had to move forward and to photograph. There were also then, you barely see it in the slide, there's ink applied to the bottom strip to make them modulate a little bit. I was also working, these are darkroom prints, I was also working with masks that I would tear paper and print through a mask and then flash it with light. So there was this window, this broken dark window that we were looking through that was of interest to me. After her passing, I had just moved into an old farmhouse in the hill towns, and we were overrun by mice. And I would teach all day and then come home and pour myself a glass of wine and sit there with a camera and a strobe. Had a mouse trap on the beam, and I felt like Cartier-Bresson of the mouse world. I would wait until the mouse trap went off and then make a picture of the mouse flying in the air. I did this for a year. Up below is the moment right before the trap went off, as you can see the little bump on the beam, which is the mouse sniffing, I suppose. And the picture to the right is the mouse on the ground below. I had a whole series of images about this. I would also freeze them. And periodically, I would take them out and arrange them and do group portraits. But I'm sparing you those pictures. That led me to another body of work that was called Cat and Mouse. Living out in the country, I was constantly dealing with all kinds of critters in my way and friends. So what I decided to do in this case is to get a fly strip and lay it out on a nice piece of white mat board and put it on in my barn. And that series is called Recent Arrivals. And I check it every day. And I would date their arrival time. My wife at the time, Curlin, with two of our geese. Below is me running around at night trying to catch them. That's all. This is the one sort of break in the work, although I would like to believe this timeline has many breaks. And this was a collaboration that I did with Richard Lebowitz, and it was called The Two-Man Show. And it came about because we were both And we were great friends, and we were teaching at RISD. And we happened to buy the same camera. So we decided to go out traveling together. And we would work on being in sync. We would, in this picture, that's me on the right, making the picture on the left. The left picture is Richard on the left, making the picture on the right. So they play with time in a kind of interesting way, and perception. The blonde woman in the foreground, the person making the snapshot, it was of interest. We did this for four summers in a row. I got a state grant to do this, which many of my friends complained that it was a silly thing to get state money for. This is my favorite, and I had to bring it in. We were walking on the beach at Old Orchard Beach, and there were people in the lifeguard stations making love and kissing and all this stuff, and I would climb the ladder up and say, "Excuse me, do you mind if I photograph while you're doing that?" And the woman turned to me and she said, "Oh no, I could not have you do that. I would be too embarrassed." So I said, "What if I don't look?" And I turned my back, and she said, "That would be fine." So the picture on the right is the picture that I made as they kiss. The picture on the left is Richard holding the camera in that same position back at himself with this thing going on in the background. My wife was pregnant with our first child, and at this time, we were bombarded by pictures in the media of kids who had disappeared, kids who were lost. This body of work is called Lost Child, and I was working both with mailings that I got. I would put them on a light table and photograph them, and also go to places where the place had some kind of resonance of where kids once played. At that time, milk cartons would come through with a portrait of a lost child. Every week, there'd be some advertisement, which just broke my heart, with a picture of a kid on it. How this advertising world and this very personal, awful thing going on came together was really troubling to me. And I think whenever I'm struggling with anything, I need to photograph. I've always believed that, and this isn't what everybody has to believe, but I've always thought the most vital art was made out of the real highs and lows of life. When you had a lot going on and you were feeling things really deeply. If things are fine and we're just sort of floating by, I don't find I make the art that's important to me. I think we carry those highs and lows in our hearts and in our minds throughout our lives. And for me, timeline is a kind of way of marking those times, remembering them, and somehow moving forward. So this was obviously a lost child. And this was a place where kids had scratched their initials and notes on that tree. It's, by the way, at the Greenfield, swimming hole. And a pair of socks left behind. I was interested in little things that happened, the way the flowers, and it's hard to see in the slide, how the flower is blurred because of the long exposure. On the left, there's a matchbook cover that was there with a picture of JFK on it. So all of those little things, which I wonder if anyone's ever going to see or think about, is part of the inspiration of making all of these photographs. Where lovers once carved their initials in a beech tree, over time, them turning into almost little devil's faces or something. The bottom strip is more mailings that I would get in the mail. an old charcoal kiln in Holly where kids gathered at night and drank. And I was moved by the ancient quality of that kiln with the trash left behind. And then little Sarah came into our life, my first daughter, and I had a sabbatical at that time. So my wife went to work every day and I stayed home and did childcare, which was one of the best little segments of my life. And I couldn't get into the dark room because I had little Sarah there. And I needed to make pictures. So I started working with Polaroid and then blueprints outside, cyanotypes. And I was doing Polaroid transfers and playing with the blueprint process, which is a printing process you can do out in the sun. And I felt a kind of kinship with women in the past and probably still present who would quilt at home as they did childcare. It's got a positive and a negative. The left is the positive, the right little block is a negative of little Rosie looking quite alien. Squirming around on the bed. This is another one out of that series. So I'd put Rosie in the swing-o-matic. I don't know if you guys remember that. And I would start pasting like at the table beside her, or I'd be photographing. During this time, I was aware of how tired and how weak I was getting. And I thought it was my age and this childcare thing. And I felt like there was something happening that I didn't understand. This body of work is called Untitled Passages, and they're triptychs within triptychs. So I think of those three panels as one image. And they talk about, I think, a kind of fragility and a kind of past. Hard to see because it's not real dark in here. But the image in the middle on the right, let me try that a different way. The image on the right of the middle like picture has a rope swing hanging down that's just about to break. It was frayed in the middle and about to snap. I could go through explanations of everything else. I don't think I need to. But there was something going on that I didn't understand. And I was making pictures of this threat that I felt and this exhaustion. The image in the middle is an old class portrait that I bought at a tag sale and it was falling apart and I re-photographed it. I then learned I was quite sick. I had a major life-threatening illness. I wasn't supposed to live very long, which we proved them wrong. And all I could imagine doing, and I did it, is go to a warm place and get an underwater camera and do self-portraits underwater. I would go into the ocean and I'd swim as deep as I could go. And then I would exhale my breath and let myself rise as I sort of turned over and over again in the water. And that's me and little Sarah. This group of pictures is called Chemo. And hard to see again, but that's the bottom image is me underwater. The backside of a horseshoe crab, me with like tubes coming out of my arm. I was in the hospital for 3 weeks, photographed every day. Even if I could just make a picture of the clock on the wall, because I was so weak, I somehow needed to do that. And then a piece of stone up top that reminded me of something else. This work is all hand-colored with oil paints. After getting out of the hospital, like any nut would do, I decided to go into a psychiatric hospital to make pictures. And I got access into Northampton State Hospital, where I went in once a week for a little over a year with my friend John Willis. We were given walkie-talkies, ate a talk to the guard, went in with flashlights, and hung out there for a day. This photograph is a long exposure of the outside of the hospital in high wind, which is what caused all of that blur. And they're mounted on brushed aluminum that come off the wall. And then coming off of the print are plexi panels that have transparencies in them with both text and image. And I know there's a class going on now here that's called text and image. So it's kind of interesting to point that out. The writing, which I don't know if you can see, God, it looks so much better on screen, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Is writing I was doing in the hospital. And I felt like going into those hospital rooms felt a lot like my experience in the hospital, because when I was in the hospital, I was okay. I didn't hurt. I was just exhausted. So all of the struggle, all of the pain was in my head, if that makes any sense. This I was fascinated by, where this patient, which they called them inmates back then, would do the scratching on the wall. And when I made the negative, these were all made with a 4x5 view camera, and I printed it, there was such a slight transition between the value of the wall and the scratches. It wasn't vibrant enough. It didn't speak well. So again, I went back to oil paint, and I put a wash of gray color over the wall, and then with a blunt object, I re-scratched his marks. So I felt like in some way I was collaborating with him. This is done in that same way. This was right beside the patient's locked door with a little slit in the door. And I got to read the hospital director's notes, which we won't talk about how I got to read those. But he talked about this guy who spent the day rocking back and forth on his heels and toes and would do this thing with his fingers on the wall back and forth. And they called him the maestro. And he talked about, in his mind, conducting an orchestra. What interested me with what I did with the oil paint is it flipped it. His marks, which were about an inch into a cement wall, right? He was there for probably 20, 25 years. So it was into the wall. And then by putting this oil color on there and then removing it where his fingers were, it came forward and became positive space. And I like that only because of this confusion between positive and negative, what's true and what's imagined. The end of a marriage. These are all transparencies. Oh, there's no paper print on aluminum. I would layer transparencies together to build up an image. And they are, about 2 inches in their thickness of many transparencies. And because they're on aluminum, and the aluminum I spent hours brushing and putting a surface on, when the lights hit it in a gallery, it would glow. Because there was no paper blocking it. And I love that. This is another one out of that series. Really hard to read in this slide, but it's my wife's face layered with images I made at a mica mine where they were drilling into the mica to do core samples. And the mica was beautiful, yet the drilling of these black holes into it, it was somehow painful. And then below it are Polaroids that I transferred onto acrylic. And you can't really read it, but there's our laundry in the backyard hanging. In the real print, you can see it. I shouldn't call it a print, whatever I call it. It's another group of pictures called Double Blind. And Double Blind was made while I was going to forts, old closed military forts along the East Coast. That lower thing is where there was a large gun turret at one time. And I liked that because I was going through a hard time and the forts were about a place where you could defend yourself. And I was just in awe of this beautiful quilt that was down on the turret. And all I could think of is a lover's placing that out and making love beside this black hole. Above it, which is, I think, one of the sexiest pictures I've ever made, is where they stored ammunition. Again, on top is the mica mine. On the bottom is a fort where someone drew on the wall of this falling figure. And then after that, the floor gave way. And I liked that empty space below that falling figure. That's a rotten tree on the bottom and the fort on top. So again, I'm interested in how these pictures talk to one another, right? How that tree with that dancing figure in my mind speaks to this repetition of space that both flattens and is aglow with light. Very different project. This was a kind of collaboration with John Willis. We published a book called Recycle Realities. It was made at the Irving Paper Mill right down the street on Route 2. They stored paper that was to be recycled in bales. Outside, it was about an acre of this. And again, my way is not to go once, but we went for probably 2 years, at least once a week, and the paper kept being changed because you'd be under the dark cloth trying to make a picture, and a forklift truck would come by and remove it. So it's like, wait! So the images in the paper carried pictures out of popular press, out of offset ends that they didn't use, newspapers, ads. And I was interested in how they lived in the paper, how things, again, came together, how the different images speak. I was told by someone who got the book that this was George Bush. I don't know if it's true or not. I kind of like to think it is. And that's, again, in the paper stacks, looking through with the light aglow in the background. Love this praying man with the text on the left, reads devils and other people looking out at us. These were my first inkjet prints, which I struggled with. So this is the first body of work that I came out of the darkroom. I was making 4x5 negatives and then scanning them and printing on an inkjet printer. And I made the worst prints for about 2 years, one could imagine. More paper. It was hard to stop this project. I thought that, God, I could do this the rest of my life because it kept changing. But John and I decided that was it after the book came out. Another body of work that followed that, it's called Landscape Remembered. And they had to do with images that I carried in my head and never made. So I'd go to places that to me were charged with something. And I think all the places I generally go to are places where I feel something of importance has once happened. And it has a kind of resonance to it, a kind of mystery, a kind of ambiguousness to it. This was in the fog. And then I started in the darkroom. I would take a negative, a 4x5 negative, and I would play with a bleach, a silver bleach called potassium ferrocyanide. And I'd put bleach on a brush. And I would start drawing on the negatives. And where I drew, it would remove the metal of the negative and print dark. And it was so exciting because I ruined so many negatives. So I had that tension of not wanting to ruin them. And it wasn't until about halfway through the process I smartened up and I started scanning the negative before I did that, which is the wonders of Photoshop, right? This was an abandoned building where the office wall had this mural that was peeling off of the woods, combined with bleaching that I'm doing. Okay, and that brings us up to timeline, which is the work on the walls. A timeline I've been working on for about 5 years, and they have to do with family, and landscape as metaphor, and the kinds of conversations, again, which they have with each other. On the bottom is my younger daughter, Rosie, and my hand on one of my goats, and a field in the wind. The hand on the goat and Rosie came about where we were in with the goats, and the goat started going for Rosie. So I grabbed the goat and with another hand made a picture. So again, I'm out in the world, I'm doing landscapes, and I'm working at home. And they build this narrative that in the book becomes very clear. I shouldn't say that, Tom, you cannot. In the book, which has many more plates in a certain structure, this narrative comes to life, or so people tell me. I would like to believe that the pictures I know are all very personal, but because of the imagery I'm using and how I'm putting them together, I would like to believe they talk about more universal things that we can all relate to. And that's partially because a lot of the pictures deal with a kind of iconography that we know, that we share, and that maybe we deem important. The other thing about timeline, I have to say, is I'm terrible with time. I mean, I come to class on time, as I expect you to, but I am totally lost. I've always told people I have a broken compass, internal compass, and I get mixed up in terms of time. I don't know which daughter that is, and I have a 9-year-old and a 25-year-old. So I was, you know, in this time or in that time of appropriation, where people were borrowing images out of the popular press and out of popular culture, I thought it fine that I was appropriating out of my past. So in certain prints, there'd be a picture of Rosie at 4 and of Sarah at 4, although they're years apart. And I got wonderfully confused. A lot of people get upset when they get confused. I don't. I just recognize it as one of my ways. This is my wife, Susanna, pregnant with our child, Rosie. The name of this print is called Susanna's Eyes, which I really kind of love because her tummy, that pregnant tummy, obviously overwhelms us as we first look at the photograph and as we spend time with it. I don't know about you guys, but I get lost in her eyes. Ooh, that is my wife, Susanna, up top with her hands outstretched in her neck and her breasts. A waterfall down below. Things I was writing about in a strip below that, and in the bottom middle is our X-ray rooms that have been long abandoned. I'll just say this, a phone on the right, an emergency phone where there was no phone, left in the woods, and a hole with a cat running by, which in the print you can read. That's me on the bottom left and Susanna on the right. And it has to do with another hard time that my wife was diagnosed with breast cancer. And a lot of time was spent in wait by the phone, waiting to get lab reports back. And there's that image of a phone and the shears over the window in the middle on the bottom. And then images of Suze and I in some way with our heads severed. My older daughter on top, Sarah on the right, a baby carriage left behind in the woods, and an uprooted tree. Another picture about pregnancy. Although the top image is at a fort, a military installation. That's me in the brook behind my house, a Rosie's crib, other stuff going on. Rosie asleep in the car in the back seat. Can't see it in the slide, but the bottom eye is partway open and has a gleam of light, which I love. If you get up close, you can see it here. And out the window of my studio during a snowstorm, looking down at the Deerfield River, some books and what looks like snow on top is a bed, a mattress. Again, that's Sarah on top, excuse me, Rosie on top sleeping in the car. And this thing I found, which were jars on this table with fluid in them. And the fluid was green. And that sheet was over them. And I pulled back the sheet. And that there were I believe it was insecticide or something, because there were bugs in there. But and then pictures out a plain window on the bottom. The main photograph is of an abandoned loading dock in Turner's Falls, out the plain window on the right, and smokestacks emitting smoke on the left. On the bottom right is Rosie and Suze. And on top is a cement wall with light and trees. And it was as close to the garden that I ever found in cement. It was beautiful. And I sat there for a long time. And then looking through to a house across the street with stuff on the window, marring our view, but at the same time, I would say, enhancing it. This is the new work in progress. I think there are 10 of these. And there's a change going on. Family is less prominent in these pictures. And they're more about, I think, environment. I think my gaze is more outer than inner, although it's always about both. I think, for most of us. That's the top one is looking through a screen, a window where the screens have been messed with. And I love that bottom image of that couple dancing, and then to the right of that window, that piece of wall that's been defaced, that's worn off, that is red. A nuclear power plant in the middle, and looking through broken glass at a house in snow on top. And at Niagara Falls on the bottom, in a storefront window, if you ever go, and you should, there are these old images of people in Niagara Falls. I think they were political people in a storefront window with all this wonderful reflection going on. And there were people out of the past. So there was some kind of threat that I perceived. In the brook across the street from my house, and a window with graffiti on it below. I'm very, very curious and don't quite understand how they talk to one another, but I think they do. This is a pretty complex one, hard to read, but there's an attack helicopter on the bottom. And on the extreme right of that bottom strip is a muscle man and a look down an abandoned hallway. That top part is a window with yellow flowers moving in the wind in front of it. And then in the woods. Traveling around and photographing is really what I've been doing over the last year, which I absolutely love. And this was a car accident. And you know, I pulled over like a press photographer would. And I didn't want to have anything to do with the actual car, but was interested in the atmosphere that was clouded. And then that radiation sign and the torso hanging in the window. I'm afraid talking like this could really diffuse the pictures, though, do you think? An abandoned car in the brush. I don't know if we can see it on the bottom with brush moving in the wind in front of it. Is it visible enough? And on top is a tire construct of old tires, which they lay down when they're going to blast. So they put dynamite under it and lay down this heavy bank of tires. But I just love the way it moved. Too bad you can't read this. There's a sign. I wish I could remember what it said. It was about evacuation. That's an attack helicopter again. I've been photographing in coal country recently in the Wilkes-Barre-Scranton area of Pennsylvania. And that is a piece of it on top of the coal trailings, that acres and acres of land that's covered in this landscape of coal that's not usable, or so they say, with life struggling to grow there. Underneath that, and I will point this out because I think it's important, is a billboard on the left of the X-ray of a skull. And on the extreme right is a house after a flood that's tipping over and sinking into the earth. Looking through a net at the landscape and looking in a room with a reflective wallpaper and a color image of a landscape. in Georgia, a house that's overgrown with kudzu and abandoned, and in the basement of another building. You're looking out at the green. And that's what I have for you today.